Welcome back to Paranormal Tedium, and yet more nutty goodness with a chewy centre. So come get your teeth into another episode in the series that is Rich's Complete and Utter Breakdown, where I check out the gadgets used by ghost hunters in their efforts to capture evidence of ghosts and other supernatural tomfoolery within the safety of the lard facility. I then try to determine if they're really any use whatsoever. Cue title sequence. The REM Pod, or to give its alleged Sunday name, the Radiating Electromagnetic Pod, which, according to an article on the Skeptical Inquirer website by good old Kenny Biddle, states that electromagneticity looks to be a made-up word, and found nothing in any real journals relating to the word. The article also states that it's not uncommon for the paranormal community, especially those selling these gadgets, to latch on to create sciencey-sounding terms to promote unscientific devices. No, really? It seems when intrepid ghost hunters fire at one of these bad boys, anywhere in a supposedly haunted location, they're soon inundated with helpful spirits willing to make it beep and flash on command, to the ghost hunter's heart's content.
Temperature gauge going up as well. Can you make the REM Pod stop for me, please? Make it stop.
The REM Pod was invented by Gary Galka, the same guy who invented the PSB7 Spirit Box and the MEL 8704 meter. If you want to know more about Gary and the incident that drove him into making devices for ghost hunting, then go check out my MEL meter breakdown vid. The REM Pod looks technical with its antenna, flashy lights and beepy noises, but what is it and what does it actually do? Well, the Higgy Pop website states that the REM Pod is, essentially, a capacitive circuit paired with an oscillator to generate an EM field, and that the technology is nothing new. A REM Pod is basically a modified Theremin. A what now? A Theremin? So you're telling me a REM Pod is essentially a twatting musical instrument? Fuck. The Theremin was invented by Russian engineer, and I'm going to butcher this pronunciation, Lev Sergeyevich Theremin, in 1919, and he patented it in 1928, although he called it the etherphone, and it's the only instrument you play by not touching it.
Transported to another dimension there.
I just want to say, go subscribe to Rob's channel. He's an exceptional musician and a really cool guy. I've put a link to that vid in the vid description. Also, go check out Carolina's channel. She's a phenomenal thereminist. Theremin player. I've linked to her channel too. By my estimation, that's got to be the only musical instrument used to detect the presence of ghosts. What in the twatting name of Sigourney Weaver and all that is sensible are intrepid fucking ghost hunters going to use next?
Is there anybody there? Whoa!
Is it Michael Jackson?
Before we quickly run down how a theremin works, please take the time to give this vid a thumbs up. We're working hard behind the scenes to bring you much more and more varied content. Make sure you subscribe to the channel and remember to smash the bell icon so as you don't miss out on any of this future fun. Okay, let's get into it. I may get a bit technical. As shown earlier, a theremin works when someone places their hands close to the two antenna on the device. The loop antenna is for the volume and the vertical antenna is for the pitch. But how does this actually work? The theremin is a combination of two capacitive circuits plus oscillators. But as the REM Pod doesn't have a volume control, we'll just concentrate on the pitch circuit. The pitch antenna acts as one plate within a capacitor, and your body, as it has the ability to conduct and store an electric charge, acts as the other plate. The air in between hand and antenna acts as what's known as the dielectric. A dielectric is an insulating material which is sandwiched between the two conductive plates within a capacitor. As you move your hand closer to the antenna, the capacitance of the circuit rises, thus lowers the current frequency and pitch of the oscillator. As you move your hand away from the antenna, the capacitance of the circuit lowers and raises the current frequency and pitch of the oscillator. But wait a minute, that's not what we saw and heard earlier. In fact, it was quite the opposite. That's because the oscillators within a theremin have a frequency range of 257 kHz to 260 kHz, which is way beyond the typical 20Hz to 20 kHz frequency range of human hearing. It's not exactly that, but as we get older, we tend to lose some of the upper range of frequencies to around the 15 to 17 kHz range. Being a bass player has its advantages. This is where heterodyning comes into play. Heterodyning is the process of combining the oscillating current with a fixed current to alter frequencies. This has the effect of dropping the frequencies to something similar to that of a piano, and also swapping the frequencies around. So now low becomes high, and high becomes low, which is what we normally see and hear when a theremin is being used. For an in-depth breakdown of the exact science behind how a theremin works, I'll link a vid to the YouTube channel SciShow. Gary Galka's ProMeasure website, where he sells all his ghost detecting devices, has a normal list price of $225 for the latest version of the REM Pod. How fucking much? Screw that, I'm just a poor Yorkshireman. I can't afford to fork out that kind of cash. Do you know what? I'm gonna make one. Right now. There you go. One Paranormal Tedium Theropod 9000, developed right here at the Lard facility. I knocked this beauty out for just over 35 quid. As per my EM pump build, I'll link to the parts I use for reference. Again, these are not affiliate links, and you could make yours for less by choosing a cheaper case. But I saw the hexagonal one and just had to get it. So, other than the human body, what else can trigger a REM pod? Basically anything that has capacitance. The human body, by the way, has a capacitance of approximately 180 to 200 picofarads. So plants, animals, and any other conductive materials. But how does that relate to an investigation? Well, it's not beyond the realms of possibility for flying insects, moths, etc., to trigger a REM pod and not be picked up on camera. Or if it is picked up, then it'll probably just look like a blob of light and be explained away as an orb. Also, the aforementioned Kenny Biddle article goes into how two-way radios can trigger a REM pod from a distance of between approximately 6 to 12 metres, depending on whether the REM pod is being used outdoor or indoor. And even if the radio user is on a different floor, above or below. So the potential right there is for a ghost hunting team member to be just off camera or even on another level of the same building and trigger a REM pod to make it look like ghostly interaction, whether unintentionally or not. As to what else could trigger a REM pod, that's for further research. To that end, we have a new series in the early stages of pre-production entitled The Paranormal Experiments. In this mini-series, Steve and I will be delving deeper into a few of the pieces of equipment used by ghost hunters and putting them through their paces to see if they actually do what ghost hunters claim they do. I've had some ideas for a while now, so it'll be great to finally put them into practice. With all that in mind, make sure you subscribe to the channel and remember to click the bell icon. That way you'll stay up to date with all that's going on here at Paranormal Tedium. We've got more varied, and hopefully more frequently posted, content planned, so we hope you'll stick around for that. Please give this vid a thumbs up. It helps with the old YouTube algorithm, and the number of likes we get on each vid gives us incentive to do more. Thanks for watching.